Everybody, great to have you along. Thank you so much for starting your week right here, Hockey Night Online. Mike Brophy, of course, the senior writer over at CBC Sports. I am David Amber, and we're into the stretch run. Can we officially say that?
We're into the stretch run. Finally, all that lead up to the Olympics now, it's a distant memory, and we're just concentrating on NHL.
Yeah, regular season, a month in duration, and then we're into the postseason. If you want to reach out to us, we always ask you to. It's either at Hockey Night, at David Amber, hashtag Hockey Night, Facebook/Hockey Night. In Canada. We always like to hear what you guys are thinking. Let's get right to the questions. 8 games tonight, 5 Canadian teams, all sorts of different storylines to delve into. And our first viewer question comes courtesy of Jordy Seeley. All right, bro, if the playoffs started now, what Canadian teams would we see in the playoffs? And this is kind of cool.
This is really old school. It's almost like Original Six. If the playoffs started today, the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Montreal Canadiens would be the only two Canadian teams that would be in the playoffs. Montreal Canadiens, of course, added Thomas Vanek at the trade deadline in an effort to make a bit of a push to become a more serious playoff team. But the downside is, of course, they don't have Carey Price. Toronto Maple Leafs, Phil Kessel has really emerged. Are there any doubts about Phil Kessel being a star in the NHL now, second leading scorer in the league, well on his way to his very first 40 goals season in the NHL. Of course, the Maple Leafs did their upgrades for the most part last year in the summer.
Yeah, and when I said it was cool, I didn't mean it was cool that 5 Canadian teams were going to miss the postseason. What I meant was they would be set up to play one another in the postseason. We haven't seen the Leafs and the Habs face each other in the postseason since 1979. We weren't born at that point, so we have no recollection.
And of course, there's still time still time for the other Canadian teams to make
Absolutely.
The playoffs. Obviously, Ottawa and Vancouver are 4 points out of a wild card. Winnipeg's 5 points out. But the way these games go, David, it's very difficult to leapfrog over other teams, especially when teams get that bonus point for taking it into overtime or the shootout.
Something the NHL is looking at the Board of Governors meeting right now down in Florida is, do they have a different point system moving forward? So again, it would be Montreal and Toronto, the only two Canadian teams in the postseason. However, the only good news there is they'd be facing each other for the first time since
79,
which would be very cool. We got another question regarding the overall standings and the situation. Is the new playoff format making that big a difference in who is making the playoffs compared to the old? That's from Avalanche 318. That's a good question, and we have to kind of jog our memories back to last year when there were 6 divisions. There's only 3 to 4 divisions now.
Yep.
Break it down for us, bro. This is the East.
Well, is it making that big a difference? I would say no, it's not a huge difference. But what it does do, David, is that in the old system, obviously, the 6 division leaders qualified for the playoffs. So if you had a weak division, and we all can remember the South Leafs division, then you would have a team getting into the playoffs that probably didn't deserve to be there. And that's not the case anymore. And of course, Detroit Red Wings and Columbus Blue Jackets go from the West to the East. Mm-hmm. Winnipeg goes to the West. And it's a real change. You know, if Detroit was in the Western Conference
right now.
Right
there nipping at Dallas's heels,
exactly,
as would Columbus.
Exactly. So Dallas is probably a benefactor. I like this system a little bit better because it really takes away that possibility of a weak division's leader getting into the postseason, pardon me, and a team that should be in the playoffs being bumped out.
And the other interesting thing to keep an eye on, we told you the Leafs and Habs would play each other. Under the old format, they wouldn't be playing each other, but it's going to be the teams that finish 2nd and 3rd in their division will play each other in the first round. So you're going to see a lot more of the Toronto-Montreal, Toronto-Boston, conceivably Montreal-Ottawa. You're going to see a lot more of those matchups and a lot more as well for possibly down the road, Edmonton and Calgary and Vancouver playing each other in the first and second round, which is very cool.
Exactly. And, you know, they always say the first round of the NHL playoffs is the most exciting, and it certainly is. And now we've got an opportunity to even ratchet it up a little bit higher.
All right, let's get the fans' voice heard yet again as we roll on Hockey Night Online. Another question from Crazy Four Leafs. How many points do you think the Leafs can realistically get on this road trip? And if you're not aware of the Leafs road trip, it's a tough one. 5 games starting tonight: LA, Anaheim, San Jose, at Washington, at Detroit. So 5 tough games. What are you expecting from them, bro?
Well, I keep hearing that if the Leafs come away 500 on this trip, it's going to be successful. I don't quite view it that way. I think if they come out the Anaheim, San Jose, LA portion of the trip, if they're 500 in that leg of the trip, then that's a successful, because those are 3 Stanley Cup favorites. When you look at Washington and Detroit, I think those are 2 winnable games for the Maple Leafs. I think the Maple Leafs are better than the Capitals. They're better than the Red Wings, who obviously have injury situations that they have to deal with. So, you know, I'm thinking the Maple Leafs should get 4 points in that leg of the trip, but if they get 3 in the first half, Boy, oh boy, this is a really tough trip, and especially getting used to the time change. They're not used to going to the West Coast, that three-hour difference.
Yeah, Nazem Kadri described it to me as the toughest five-game stretch of the season. If they could off 7 points out of 10, that would be quite a feat, especially going into the Bermuda Triangle, known as the California Three-Step, which they start tonight in Anaheim. All right, another question rolling your way on Hockey Night Online, this one concerning the Montreal Canadiens. Any word on Price's injury? Remember, Carey Price, comebacks from the Olympics, lower body injury. O'Leary's Irish pub wants to know.
I'll tell you what, they're really being guarded about this for obvious reasons. He was put on IR dated back to February 26th, which I believe means he can come off the IR on Tuesday. You know, I don't think there's a rush right now to get Carey Price back. I think as long as the Montreal Canadiens continue to be successful, they're going to be very, very sure that he's at 100% before they bring him back. They know they're going to be in the playoffs. They know that they're going to ride Carey Price really hard for a couple months in the playoffs. If he's got a lower body injury, that is something that could linger into the postseason. I don't see any upside to rushing him back. And I don't get the sense that it's an overly serious injury, because he was still able to play with that injury while in the Olympics.
And win gold.
Exactly, and play terrific.
Prof, isn't this what drives GMs and coaches in the NHL nuts? The guys go off to the playoffs, doesn't say a word. Mike Babcock said, I didn't know he had any injury. They claim, the Montreal Canadiens, that it was aggravated during the run to gold in Sochi. We saw a numerous players, Zetterberg, go down with a significant injury. John Tavares done for the year. Carey Price, aggravating injury. Is this ultimately what's probably going to keep, or possibly going to keep, NHLers from the games four years from now?
It certainly plays into the equation of keeping the NHLers out of the Olympic Games. Mm-hmm. I think the fact that the NHL is missing an opportunity to make a lot of money by running its own World Cup of Hockey is also going to play into the equation. But boy, oh boy, you shut your league down for a couple of weeks, and then when they come back, you're missing star players. I don't know how you can justify continuing to do that.
All right, again, we roll on with questions. We'd like to hear your voice heard, of course, on Hockey Night Online. Will the Oilers ever turn the corner and finally improve? An impatient John Tellman. And listen, they've, 8 years of futility, so many number one overall picks. Do you see them turning the corner soon?
Well, I hate to disappoint you, John, but no, they will never get better.
I mean,
obviously, I'm joking. Yeah. They've got this talented group of youngsters that they got because of their poor finishes through the draft. And I like this group of players, but all they're doing so far in their NHL careers is learning how to be paid a lot of money and learning how to lose. So I think until Craig McTavish comes up with a way to improve the third and fourth lines, bring in some quality veteran NHL players, preferably guys who have won before, get a stud on defense, and get dependable goaltending. I mean, that's the same thing every team needs to be better, but they're just really spinning their wheels right now because they haven't gone out and acquired the pieces that they need. It's one thing to build through the draft and get good young players the way the Oilers have, but if you don't bring in the right players to surround those talented players, you're never going to get anywhere, and that's what we're seeing with the Edmonton Oilers to date.
Well, let me follow up there. They're going to get another very high draft pick this year. If you're Craig McTavish, do you need to make that big splash that he talked about when he took over? Do they need to pull the trigger on a significant deal, and not these periphery ones, but a significant one where they deal one of their prize, you know, whether it's Hall or Eberle or Nugent Hopkins, one of the big guys?
I really think they do, and I think the problem in Edmonton is they've fallen in love with this group of young players. You've got to fall out of love with one of those players, sell them big time, and try to get back the pieces that you need. If you don't have solid goaltending, maybe Ben Scrivens is the guy, but right now I'm not 100% sold on that. Unless you get a stud on defense, look at all the teams that are Stanley Cup contenders. Mm-hmm. They all have a stud, a guy who can play, you know, high 20 minutes and really shut teams down. Edmonton Oilers don't have that guy, so it's the goaltending, the defense, and those support players on the third and fourth lines that go out, and those are the guys that can make the difference in making the playoffs, or if you get to the playoffs, winning a round.
I'll be perfectly honest. I thought this was the year they were going to break out and make the postseason. That's certainly not happening. In fact, it was done by basically the end of October. One player they have fallen out of love with is Nail Yakupov, but you're not going to be able to move him right now because you're not going to get what you deserve.
There's no
back
market,
in return.
Is there?
We will wait and see. So that's an interesting team to keep an eye on, not making the postseason this year, but certainly with some optimism moving forward. Finally, our final question. For how many more years do you think the Western Conference will be this competitive? That comes from Mo. It's funny because these things are cyclical, right? I mean, there was a time when the East dominated, and right now we see the West is very, very strong.
I think it's going to be strong for a number of years to come. And the reason why is you look at the top stars on the Western Conference teams. Getzlaff and Perry are in the prime of their career. They're still going to be very good players. Taves and Kane, these guys are in the prime of their career. You look at Minnesota with Parise and Suter, and think about next year when they either keep Matt Molson or they get Thomas Vanek.
Yeah.
You know, and then you look at St. Louis, LA, San Jose. Of that group of teams, the only team I'm a little worried about is the San Jose Sharks, because their veteran players are getting a little bit long in the tooth. So at some point, they're going to have to move some younger players in. But the St. Louis Blues are a young hockey team. The LA Kings, for the most part, are a young hockey team. So I don't see any reason why for the next 5 or 6 years, the Western Conference can't remain to be the strongest conference.
And one player could shift that tide a little bit. His name's Connor McDavid. Not this year, but next year's draft. If that guy ends up in the West as well, that's another dominant piece. We're talking about a franchise-type generational player coming into the NHL in 2 years. All right, I hope you enjoyed. Again, join us each and every day right here, 11 o'clock Eastern time, Hockey Night Online. Here's how to connect with us, at Hockey Night, at David Amber, hashtag Hockey Night. Like, we got to get your ad.
At Hockey Brof.
At Hockey Brof as well. And Facebook/Hockey Night in Canada. Again, join in the conversation. We're into the stretch run of the regular season. Thanks so much for joining us. For Mike Brophy, I'm David Amber. We'll see you next time. Hockey Night Online.